I want to give you a short introduction into MPEG V. So it's not MPEG 5. A lot of people think it's MPEG 5. It's MPEG V for virtual worlds. And introduce that by the architectures and use cases that we use to set up the standard. As I said already this morning, my name is Jean Gelissen. I work for Philips Research in Eindhoven, the Netherlands. And if we talk about missing something here, there's no Philips. Oh. Yeah, I noticed that already before. Yeah, that's okay, it's no problem. Yes, I said one of the roadblocks in the real breakthrough of virtual life is about... I have to stay in the circle. Okay, I have to stay here. Yes. One of the roadblocks of massive introduction and use of virtual worlds is about interoperability, because everybody does his own thing and they are not, you cannot work together with those things. You cannot connect them to the physical world. Well, that was one of the aims of the Metaverse One project and also of the MPEG V standard. So let me start with introducing MPEG V. Sorry, the Metaverse initiative. The Metaverse initiative, we started at this outline event in 2007, as was already mentioned earlier this morning, was to create global standards among real and virtual worlds. The words have been taken very carefully, and also in the standardization, we had to be very carefully with the worlds, not to upset people. We were not defining a new universal virtual world, because a lot of people thought that. We went together to the US to a big conference over there with a lot of people in virtual world development and exploitation, and they were also afraid that we would come up with something like a global virtual world. That's not the idea. We want to talk about bridging the gaps between virtual worlds and between virtual worlds and the real worlds. So we will come back later to that. And by this, creating your next life, and as Jesse introduced, it's all about 3D, 3C. So something from our founding fathers, the IDEA 2, the Metaverse One project is an IDEA 2 project. IDEA 2 is also known in, of course, it's an Eureka cluster project. It's also known in Israel. Israel is this year the chairman of Eureka. And IDEA stands for Information Technology for European Advancement. It is also, of course, something to stay ahead of what is happening in the US and in Japan and in Korea and so on. That was the initiative. That was the intention 12 years ago, I think, when this all started. We are already in the IDEA 2. That is the second program. People are talking now about IDEA 3 because IDEA 2 is ending. It's stimulate and support the development of software technology for the benefit of the European industry. That is the main challenge. You see some figures here about what has been done already. It's a big program, and I'm happy to say that at this moment, Metaverse One project is the biggest IDEA project that is running at the moment, and also got a lot of visibility. Although if you do a project in IDEA that is related to the car industry or to the medical industry, you have also a very high attention level. But Rudolf Hagemeyer, who is the chair of IDEA, really likes our project, so that's good. So what we intended to do with the Metaverse One initiative is provide a global framework to enable the interoperability. So not to redefine virtual worlds or define virtual worlds, no. A global framework to enable interoperability between virtual worlds that allows people like a lot of you entrepreneurs that are sitting here to trade goods in virtual worlds, that you don't have to develop your stuff for every virtual world again. So it allows you to create it in a kind of universal format that you can then import into different virtual worlds. It also gives the possibility to users who used your stuff and enhanced it or trained it or whatever you can do with it to export it from one virtual world into this universal format and import it again into another virtual world. Of course, if you allow that from a commercial point of view. That's the idea behind it first part. The second part is also to connect the virtual worlds to the many things that are available in the real world. And then, of course, we think about, and that has the most attention at the moment, also from the audience here, all the sensors and the actuators that we have in the real world. In fact, you always when you communicate with the virtual world, you always use sensors and actuators, being the mouse, the keyboard, the touch screen, and the feedback that you get through the screen and the audio devices or whatever. Right? So you already use all kinds of sensors and actuators, but we extend that into many more dimensions, as you will see later. But also connecting to all kind of other, let's say, 2D world system that are already in the internet domain. And well, the initial idea that Victor presented when we talked about this in 2007 was indeed to create a kind of virtual city. And when you walked into that virtual city and you went into a restaurant or a hotel or a bank, you ended up in the virtual space of that company or institute or whatever. Right? So that's also connecting those two, those multiple worlds. So that was the idea also here. Last but not least, also very important also in the context of Europe, we want to avoid the e-inclusion of minorities of the society. And minorities, I also talked about that last night at the dinner. Minorities in the society can be all kinds of population groups. It's not always the people that lag behind that you think about from an economical point of view. It has to do with culture, it has to do with education level and so on. So while we are moving more and more into the information society and into virtual worlds and simulation models and game and serious games and those kind of things, some people, some population groups might lag behind because they cannot follow it. And also I think 3D, the 3D part you introduced is important in that. Eh? Representing it in 3D, like you showed the picture from Japan, eh? this very complicated representation on the traditional way is very cumbersome for a lot of people. If you really present it like it is in real life, it's much easier for people. And if you also allow them to maneuver through that, to navigate through that in a natural way in three dimensions, it makes the accessibility for people much greater. That's very important. The project as it is started with an initial consortium of 47 partners of 8 countries. I especially show that here because GeoSim Systems is still on this page. That was the original proposal that we submitted. Also, the consortium in France changed a lot because in France we initially had a very interesting use case, but the French government did not like that because it was too close to the security of the country. It was on nuclear, very popular, very relevant at the moment, yes. In fact, it was, if we would have done it, it would have made the things that are happening now in Japan easier.
Yes,
because it was a virtual world that would allow all the emergency organizations that are involved in such an event as happened now in Japan to train, but also to coordinate in the virtual world. They missed that now. We could, but the French Atomic Agency said, no, we don't want to do that in an European project. That was the idea then. So we came up with a complete new consortium in France and new challenges. And also we lost the German consortium due to funding reasons. So currently the project is consisting of 32 partners out of 6 participating countries. And I think it's a very nice distribution of a large industry, SME and academia and institutes. So a very nice group of people together. Okay, now I move to MPEG-V, to the architectures and the use cases. In fact, this is not the start of the project, but this is the way that standards are built. Standards are built out of need. Standards are not built because people have nice stuff and they want to push it somewhere. No, in a standardization like MPEG, which is a royalty-bearing standard, so there are commercial interests behind it, there really needs to be a need. So you start with a document which is called an objectives document, where you really explain why such a standard in this area is needed, and then the ISO, the national bodies that compose ISO, vote on that and say whether you can start the standard or not. And we were very lucky, because initially it was intended to be part of another standard, of MPEG-4 in fact, because it has to do with 3D graphics and so on. But we got our own standard, which is MPEG-V, and the number is 23005. So something about Metaverse and MPEG-V and the position of that in the standardization world. So early 2007, we started already with talking about that. So really before the project started to allow to get pretty far with the standardization during the course of the project, because I thought that was pretty important. And as a matter of fact, we managed to do that, because we had in January we had the MPEG meeting in Daegu in Korea, where we had a special awareness event for MPEG-V, and that was also to celebrate the release of the first version of the complete standard. And also Yesha was there and gave, we had a whole morning workshop and a 2-day exposition where a lot of our project stuff was also demonstrated. So I don't know if I have to say a lot about MPEG, because most people in this audience will probably know it. MPEG is already existing for more than 21 years. We had, at the moment, there is the 96th meeting in Geneva. I'm not there, so I missed that one. I've been in 54 of those 96 meetings. Very special for standardization body. They received 3 Emmy Awards, which is very special for a standardization body. But of course, they did a lot for the movie industry. That's clear. And the track record of MPEG is quite big, especially the MPEG 2, of course, is a very important standard, which is the basis for DVD, for digital TV, for everything, camcorders and so on. But also MPEG 4 is pretty important for all the cameras that we carry around nowadays. Also all the recording capacities in your video recording capacities in your iPhones or Androids or whatever are based on this standard. From IDEA point of view, we have been pretty successful also there. So MPEG-E multimedia middleware is a result of a previous series of projects I did in this context. But then we needed 3 projects, so in total 9 years to get to the standard in the end. Now we did it in 3 years, eh? So that's really good. So MPEG-V is really the result of the MPEG-V of the Metaverse One initiative. So if I go into the standard itself, MPEG-V defines an architecture that provides interoperability for information exchange with virtual worlds. And also these words are chosen very precisely. With virtual worlds, that means from the outside, and that means between. But we don't worry about the inside. It took quite some time to get to this one sentence. It's also the name of the standard, by the way. It allows for simultaneous reactions in both worlds to changes in the environment and human behavior. That means between virtual worlds, it means between the physical world and the virtual world, and the other way around. Well, of course, standard terms about efficiency, effectiveness, and so on are also very important here, because that was also looked at. So the whole standard has been use case driven. Use cases have been crucial for the development of the standard. We gathered all the requirements from these use cases. We used them during the design and the development and implementation. You should read here as reference software, because if you develop a standard, you also have to prove that it can work. I don't say works, but can work, because the performance and things like that and the cost are not part of the things that you have to prove, but you have to prove that it could work. And that's the basis also for then this reference software and the conformance. So you see here a lot of use cases that we have used to build up the standard, ranging from a lot of things that we do in this project, but also things that came from Japan and Korea, because Japan and Korea got very active into the standard after we started it. And you will see some of them back. I put here the MPEG-V awareness event, because that a lot of these use cases were shown at this awareness event. We had a quite impressive presentation there. And this is what it is. So after, I put there after many iterations, because it took us a lot of time in the standards body, in ad hoc groups, to discuss about how it should look like, how we should position all the elements in the standard. But this is in the end the result that we got. It's very colorful, I know that. I like colors. So what is important are 3 parts that are the blue color parts, because that are the core elements of the standard. The standard has 7 parts at the moment. But these 3 are the most important one, and they also comprise parts 2, 3, and 4. And the rest is stuff I do. That's the architecture, but that's just describing the whole thing. And the other parts at the end are common formats about data representation, about how you stream the content, and 1 part about the reference software and the components. But the most important parts are the blue ones. If I look at this one, is really information exchange between virtual world and the real world bidirectional on a high abstraction level. And there you talk about something I want to, for instance, from a game, I want to have a thunderstorm moving from that side of the scene to that side of the scene with a certain intensity and a certain speed. Then this goes into the adaptation part, which is not standardized, because that is where you put your innovation power, because that is your product that you're going to develop to bridge the between this part of the standard and this part of the standard. This part of the standard is really the lower level interface to the devices. So there you really talk about, well, I got this this request to create a thunderstorm. I know what kind of devices I have connected. That is a kind of plug and play concept. So we have we know what kind of devices we have in that current situation. There is also the possibility to provide user, well, you should say restrictions, not user need, but restrictions, because, for instance, you don't want we also talk about vibrating shares and so on, and in a certain moment you don't want to, you want to limit the intensity of those effects. So you say don't go over a certain threshold, so that are the user inputs. And then this adaptation engine translate the experience that is wanted into the possibilities that there are with the physical devices that you have in the environment, and creates a sequence of events that represent this thunderstorm. So that is the basis of this part. That is really the biggest part that has been taken up in the standard, because especially in Korea and Japan, they like big shows with a lot of thunder and lightning and all those kind of things. So that's what they use this for, professional use in those kind of things. But also, of course, to extend games and so on, or even Second Life has been extended with this feature to drive additional peripherals that you have in your living room.
Fans,
lights. They even talk about rain. So it smell doesn't stop. The sky is the limit here. So that's the most challenging part, especially in Japan and Korea. The part 4 of the standard talks about interfaces between virtual world. In fact, we talked there about avatar and avatar characteristics. But an avatar, for the avatar, we have extended the model of the avatar. In fact, we have attached all the goods that you have in a virtual world. We attach them to the avatar. We could have done it the other way around, but yeah, they are owned by an avatar, so we connected them to the avatar. So that talks about, of course, about avatar characteristics. And it talks about the virtual goods that you can connect to the avatar. And there are a lot of things, like we also did from our project, like body language and all those kind of things. A lot of things have been added there. So now I move into the number of instantiations of the standard, because this is the total standard. You probably never use this in total, because this standard would allow you to go also from a real world 1 to a real world 2 on the other side of the world, through the virtual worlds, multiple virtual worlds. People might do that, but that's not the most obvious way to use this, of course. So you can make instantiations of this total standard, and have use cases specific for that instantiation. So the first one is pretty simple. It is generating a sensory experience from a game or a DVD or whatever you have into the physical world. So that's one direction only, except for, of course, the user preferences and the physical, how do you call that, the device elements that you have in your real world have to be made known to the adaptation engine. And this is something that was developed already by A3, and that they really use to build those experiences in museums and in shows and things like that. By the way, this is also the basis of something that Philips has created many years ago, which was MBX. That was an extension kit for your PC, where you could add light and fans and all that kind of things to a game. That's exactly the same concept. And we also brought that in. So you see that represented here. Normally you have the traditional audio-video only game or DVD experience where you have a screen and some speakers, and that's it. And in this case, so with the sensory experience metadata that are coming from the medium, you can address all kind of devices in the user space and trigger them. Okay, the next one is the bidirectional mapping for information exchange between virtual worlds and the real world. So that's going in both directions. And an example of that is what I would call virtual karaoke. There is no real name for it, but I called it when I saw it 2 years ago. This TV is from Samsung. It's not a coincidence. It's done by Samsung. And it's really an extension of the very popular karaoke. It's still very popular in Korea and Japan. And the idea is here that this picture doesn't show it, but this is another way of using it. But what I really want to do is that you can dance with a dancer in the virtual world. So instead of sing along, it's dance along. And there is a camera that captures you and translates your movements into the virtual world and adapts the avatar that really dances with you. And you see yourself dancing on the screen with an avatar on your favorite music. They really think will be the next karaoke. Of course, what we do in our project, and you will see that later today, is also an example of this. We have also bidirectional, because we navigate through virtual worlds and we get feedback out of the virtual world, for instance, by sound. And you will see that later. It's one of our use cases. The instantiation number 3 is really the information exchange between virtual worlds, so not going into the physical world. Well, and I already heard people that are also present here that do that. That was also inspired at that time by this Chinese company, which was the first millionaire in virtual good. Yeah. We also had a telco with them at that time. So this is very clear to you, and also in Korea and Japan, this has a lot of interest to make this possible. The unidirectional, the other way around, like compared to the first one I presented, is mapping the control of avatars in the virtual world based on objects in the real world. There are a lot of things in Korea that I like to do with that, in the area of education, where they enhance education by triggering things in the virtual world based on movements or triggers that the user do. So there is a lot of interest there in the educational world. Whether it is implicit triggers that the user do or implicit, like this wristband that just measures how a student is behaving, so can adapt the training program when they find out that the user is not feeling comfortable anymore. So when they get anxious that maybe the learning material is too complex or too fast, so they adopt the learning material. But also, of course, by having physical objects where you push something in a book and then you get some additional information in the virtual world about that subject. So very interesting use cases as well. And then I have one more for the other way around, which is really something which is very popular in, you have been in it, they call it the rocking chair. So they really like to shake you while you are experiencing a movie, for instance. And I think they overdone the effect, by the way, because you really were rocked after you came out like this. But okay, they're really in amusement parks and all those kind of things, of course, where they want to bring to this. This brings me to the end of what we have done for the standard so far. We don't stop here, so we have released the standard officially in November last year, but that's the official ISO release, and then still things have to happen. So the formal release was during the event we had in January in Korea. The standard already moved about 1 year ago. People start to work on what they call Amendment 1. It's mostly those amendments are used to correct things in the standard as it is. But in this case, it's really a second edition of the standard, where a lot of new things are being introduced. And you see that it also moves into other areas than just the entertainment area. It really moves into what I call then more serious business, with biosensors, gas and dust sensors, gaze tracking for commercial use, attributed coordinate sensors, multi-point sensors, wind sensors, navigation sensors. So really use more commercial, enabling more commercial use cases. And then you should think about the things that, that are listed here below, about really mental health, food intake, that are things that we are doing ourselves, managing the people with health problems, to manage them to have a more comfortable life, so that they are always monitored and that things can be in can be done to help them when things get out of control. But also something also at this time very serious for Japan again is this unmanned aerial vehicle scenario, where you can send a kind of very tiny helicopter with cameras and sensors, for instance, into such a nuclear power plant where people can't come anymore. In fact, it's being done at the moment, but not in this fancy way as we want to do it here. Well, and motion tracking, facial animation, all those kind of things. Eh? Because people also see a lot of potential in the retail market, where you monitor people and want to register where they are looking at, also in order to do the pricing and the advertisement and all that, personal advertisement, all that kind of stuff. So the next step is really already launched, and it will be interesting as well. That was my story. Thank you for your attention.